Hello, welcome to EPG Pathshala on Biophysics, Paper 2, Quantum Biophysics. In this paper, today we are going to take up Module 10, the Molecular Orbital Theory of the Hydrogen Molecule. The valence bond method discussed in Module 9 offered a quantum mechanical approach to describe molecular properties. In this module, we will discuss at an elementary level the alternative molecular orbital approach for the same purpose. The major conceptual difference between the molecular orbital method and the valence bond method lies in the degree of delocalization of electrons in the molecule. In the former method, the concept of a molecular orbital is introduced, which may involve all of the atoms in the molecule. In contrast, the valence bond orbital is constructed from a limited number of atomic orbitals. Historically, during the period Slater and Pauling were developing the Heitler-London approach into their valence bond theory, Mulliken and Hund were laying down the foundation of the molecular orbital theory from a spectroscopic perspective. Although in the initial years, valence bond theory was more popular due to its close correspondence with the intuitive chemical concepts of bonding, over the years, molecular orbital method has gained in popularity due to its ability to explain structures and spectra. The easy availability of very powerful computational programs based on the molecular orbital method also provides additional reason to master and apply this technique. In this module, our objectives are to acquire a basic understanding of the idea of molecular orbitals, to learn how to apply the technique for simple cases like the hydrogen molecular ion and the hydrogen molecule, to understand the concept of bonding and antibonding orbitals, to be able to calculate bond order for simple molecular species. So, in the molecular orbital method, we again solve the Schrödinger equation for the molecule and we invoke the Born-Oppenheimer approximation, which we have discussed in the previous module. Here, we discuss a very simple system, in fact, the simplest system of a molecule, which is the hydrogen molecular ion. It contains two protons and one electron. Now, let us suppose that the nuclei that is protons A and B are separated by a distance, say R, from each other. And let us also suppose that the position vector of the electron is given by the vector R, and the electrostatic energy will be determined by the distance variables Ra and Rb of the electrons from the two nuclei A and B. We can then write the Hamiltonian in atomic units as this equation. The Hamiltonian is composed of four different terms. The first term is minus half del square, that is equal to, that gives the kinetic energy of the electron. The second term is minus 1 by Ra, that gives the electrostatic attraction between the electrons and the proton A. The third term is minus 1 by Rb. This again gives the electrostatic attraction between the electron and the proton B. And the fourth term is 1 by R, which is the electrostatic repulsion between the two protons A and B. If you have observed carefully, the Hamiltonian does not contain any electron-electron repulsion term. And the absence of this electron-electron repulsion term allows an exact solution of the Schrödinger equation. But arriving at such solutions is a very complicated task.
Also, we can ignore the constant repulsion term of the fixed protons under the Born-Oppenheimer approximation. In the molecular orbital approach, we do not go for an exact solution of the Schrödinger equation. We look for an approximate solution that is very easy to arrive at, and this approximate solution is based on the molecular orbital approach. This is much easier to understand, and it has the advantage that further refinements to this approach can be carried out. In the molecular orbital method, we assume the electron to be predominantly located either in the neighborhood of proton A or of proton B. When the electron is near proton A, the effect of proton B on its wave function is small, so that it can be approximated by the 1s orbital of a hydrogen atom centered on proton A. Similarly, when the electron is near proton B, its wave function will be approximated by the 1s orbital of a hydrogen atom centered on proton B. Now, the ground state wave function for the electron is then written as a linear combination of these atomic orbitals, and this is known as LCAO, linear combination of atomic orbitals. So it looks like psi, the ground state wave function, is equal to C1 1SA plus C2 1SB, where 1SA is the 1s orbital of the hydrogen atom centered at A, and 1SB is the 1s orbital of the hydrogen atom centered at B. And C1 and C2 are two unknown parameters that are known as LCAO coefficients. The parameters C1 and C2 can be determined by proceeding from the normalization of the wave function, integral psi square dV, that is equal to 1, where dV is the elementary volume element. Now, if both 1SA and 1SB are normalized atomic orbitals, normalization condition leads to the equation C1 square plus C2 square plus 2C1 C2S equals 1, where this S is the overlap integral, which is normally very small in magnitude but is not equal to 0. S is given by integral of 1SA into 1SB dV. Now, the molecular orbital has to satisfy the Schrödinger equation with the Hamiltonian that we defined earlier, and that is H psi equals E psi. As we have told previously, we are not interested to find an exact solution. If we can determine the unknown parameters C1 and C2, then we can determine the molecular orbital and we can calculate the corresponding energy E. Now, one of the way is to expand the Schrödinger equation in terms of the atomic orbitals to arrive at the secular equation using the variational principle. And the secular equation looks like this: determinant of H11 minus ES11, H12 minus ES12, H21 minus ES21, H22 minus ES22, that is equal to 0. Now, how do we arrive at the secular equation? Let us briefly recapitulate the mathematical steps involved in the variational method. In the previous module, we took an arbitrary quantum system and considered its ground state. The ground state wave function psi 0 and the ground state energy E0 obey the Schrödinger equation, H psi 0 equals E 0 psi 0. Now for simplicity, let us consider all the functions to be real valued. Now let us multiply this equation from the left by psi 0 and integrate over the entire space. Then E 0 equals integral psi 0 H psi 0 dV divided by integral psi 0 square dV. The denominator may not in general be unity unless the wave function has been normalized. There is a theorem which states that substituting any other function phi for psi 0 will give us a quantity E phi that is equal to integral phi h phi dv, integral phi h phi dv divided by integral phi square dv, which must be greater than the ground state energy, that is E phi greater than or equal to E 0. The equality holds only when phi equals psi 0. This result is known, as we have seen in the previous module, as the variational principle and the theorem, the variational theorem. Now, how did we prove the variational theorem? The proof is quite simple. We can expand the function phi in terms of the eigenfunctions of our Hamiltonian. Phi equals C0 psi 0 plus C1 psi 1 plus C2 psi 2 plus other terms. Then integral phi h phi dv equals integral C0 psi 0 plus other terms into h into C0 psi 0 plus other terms dv. And this can be written as E0 C0 square plus E1 C1 square plus similar terms if the eigenfunctions are orthonormal. Similarly, integral phi square dv equals C0 square plus C1 square plus other terms, and this is equal to 1 if phi is normalized. Now from this, E phi equals E0 C0 square plus E1 C1 square plus similar other terms, and this must be greater than or equal to E0 C0 square plus E0 C1 square plus similar other terms, which should be equal to E0, since E1, E2 and other higher energies have magnitudes greater than E0. Therefore, E phi greater than or equal to E0 with the equality holding only when phi equals psi 0. Now the significance of the variational principle is that we can calculate an upper bound to E0 by using any trial function. The closer we can take phi to psi 0 in some manner, E phi will be closer to E0. And if we choose phi so that it depends on some parameters alpha, beta, gamma, which we will call variational parameters, the energy E phi will also depend on them. And so E phi alpha, beta, gamma greater than or equal to E0. If we minimize E phi with respect to alpha, beta, gamma, we will approach E0 from above. Now let us take phi as a linear combination of arbitrary functions f1 and f2. And for simplicity, we again assume c1, c2 and f1, f2 to be real valued. Then integral phi h phi dv equals integral c1 f1 plus c2 f2 h c1 f1 plus c2 f2 dv. Right hand side is c1 square integral f1 h f1 dv plus c1 c2 integral f1 h f2 dv plus c1 c2 integral f2 h f1 dv plus c2 square integral f2 h f2 dv. This can be written as C1 square H11 plus C1 C2 H12 plus C1 C2 H21 plus C2 square H22, where Hij equals integral Fi HFj dv. Because the Hamiltonian H is Hermitian, Hij equals Hji, or integral psi H psi dv equals C1 square plus 2C1 C2 H12 plus C2 square H22. In a similar manner, we can write integral phi square dv equals C1 square S11 plus 2C1 C2 S12 plus C2 square S22, where Sij equals Sji equals integral phi I phi j dv. So if I equals E as a function of C1 C2, and that is equal to C1 square H11 plus 2C1 C2 H12 plus C2 square H22 divided by C1 square S11 plus 2C1 C2 S12 plus C2 square S22, or E C1 C2 into C1 square S11 plus 2C1 C2 S12 plus C2 square S22 equals C1 square H11 plus 2C1 C2 H12 plus C2 square H22. Now let us differentiate this with respect to C1. Then we get 2C1 S11 plus 2C2 S12 E plus del E del C1 into C1 square S11 plus 2C1 C2 S12 plus C2 square S22 equals 2C1 H11 plus 2C2 H12. Since we are trying to minimize E, we put del E del C1 equals 0, which gives us C1 H11 minus ES11 plus C2 H12 minus ES12 equals 0. Similarly, we get C1 H12 minus ES12 plus C22 H22 minus ES22 equals 0 by putting del E by del C2 equals 0. This gives us a pair of linear algebraic equations for C1 and C2 to have a non-trivial solution, that is a solution other than the trivial solution C1 equals C2 equals 0. The determinant of the coefficients must vanish. And thus, we arrive at the secular equation, determinant of H11 minus ES11, H12 minus ES12, H21 minus ES21, H22 minus ES22 equals 0. And this determinant is called the secular determinant. This can be generalized to n such functions, that is phi equals sum over capital N Cn Fn. Then the secular determinant will also be an n by n determinant. So coming back to our hydrogen molecular ion problem, we have for the protons A and B, the secular determinant HAA minus ESAA, HAB minus ESAB, HBA minus ESBA, and HBB minus ESBB equals 0. Where HAA equals integral 1SA H1SA dV equals HBB, and HAB equals integral 1SA H1SB dV equals HBA. Now the overlap integrals SAA and SBB are equal to unity if the wave functions are normalized. And for the integrals HAA and HBB, one can show that HAA equals minus half plus J prime, where J prime is called the Coulomb integral. And the Coulomb integral looks like this. This is J prime equals integral 1SA into minus 1RB plus 1 by R into 1SA dV. The integral HAB on the other hand, can be written as HAB equals minus S by 2 plus K prime, where K prime is called the exchange integral. And the K prime looks like integral 1 SA into minus 1 by RA plus 1 by R 1 SB dV. As we have already noted, the overlap integrals SAB equals SBA equals S, and that is much less than 1 and can be neglected. So the coupling between two atoms leading to formation of a covalent bond is mainly due to the exchange integrals. These integrals are negative in magnitude and have a stabilizing influence. The secular determinant leads to a quadratic equation in the energy. This gives two values. E plus minus equals HAA plus minus HAB divided by 1 plus minus S, which can be written as E plus minus equals minus half plus J prime plus minus K prime divided by 1 plus minus S. If we again consider that the overlap integral S has a small value, then a major role in creating these two distinct energy levels is played by the exchange integral. Since the exchange integral is negative, the energy level E plus will be lower than E minus. Therefore, the ground state energy level for H2 plus is given by E plus. We note that minus half is the ground state energy of an isolated atom and a bare proton. Then delta E plus minus equals J prime plus minus K prime divided by 1 plus minus S is the energy of the hydrogen molecular ion relative to a separated hydrogen atom and a proton. And calculations show that the energies vary with internuclear separation. In the graph, we can see the variation of the energies with interproton distance for different states. The lowermost red line in the graph depicts the bonding state, and the green dashed line above that shows the antibonding state. At large distances, we note the energies tend to the value minus half, as expected from our theory. The energy delta E plus corresponds to a stable complex whose dissociation energy is 1.77 electron volt and equilibrium bond length is 0.132 nanometer. This does not agree that satisfactorily with the experimental values of the dissociation energy of 2.25 electron volt and bond length 0.106 nanometer. Calculations also show the energy delta E minus to decrease monotonically with increase in interproton separation, thus not leading to a stable state as we saw in the graph. Now, how does this give us the concept of bonding and antibonding orbitals? Let us first take E equals E plus. That will give us C1 into J prime minus J prime plus K prime divided by 1 plus S plus C2 into K prime minus J prime plus K prime into S divided by 1 plus S equals 0, which after simplification gives us C1 equals C2. So the wave function corresponding to this will be written as psi plus equals C1 into 1 SA plus 1 SP. And if we normalize this wave function, then we will have the expression psi plus equals 1 by square root of 2 1 plus S into 1 SA plus 1 SP. Similar calculations reveal that for E equals E minus, psi minus equals 1 by square root of 2 1 minus S 1 SA minus 1 SP. Since E plus corresponds to a state that exhibits a stable bond, it is called a bonding orbital, and the state E minus, on the other hand, does not correspond to a stable state and is called an antibonding orbital. Let us again consider the secular determinant equation. This we can rewrite as HAA minus E into HBB minus E minus HAB minus ES whole square equals 0. We can then see that if HAB and S are 0, then no covalent bonding takes place since there is no lowering of the energy level. So if S and HAB are small, the covalent bonding is proportionately small. The overlap is 0 if the atomic nuclei are far from each other. And the shorter the distance between the two nuclei, the greater the overlap becomes. A large overlap between valence orbitals is usually considered to imply a strong bond. Interestingly, the atomic orbitals used to construct molecular orbitals must have the same symmetry about the line connecting the nuclei A and B. Otherwise, S and HAB become zero, and accordingly the covalent bond does not occur. Because of the importance of symmetry, the various types of molecular orbitals are distinguished by the symmetry of the overlap. If the overlap is symmetric for rotation about the line connecting A and B, for example in the cases of SS or PZ-PZ orbitals, the orbitals are termed sigma orbitals. If the overlap creates a nodal plane, then the molecular orbital is called a pi orbital, as for example in PXA, PXB or PYA, PYB orbitals. If the overlap possesses two nodal planes which intersect along the connecting line, the orbital is called a delta orbital. The three p orbitals on the two atoms combine to form one p sigma and two p pi overlaps. It is easy to see that the pi x and pi y molecular orbitals resulting from these have the same energy. Also, since the s pi overlap is smaller than the s sigma overlap, sigma bonding should be stronger than pi bonding. The pi antibonding orbital consequently will have lower energy than the sigma antibonding orbital. The electronic configuration of diatomic molecules can be built in an analogous manner as the electronic structure of atoms. The electronic configurations are obtained by placing the electrons one after another in the empty energy levels, starting from the lowest energy level. When considering the situation for the hydrogen molecule, these orbitals may be called one electron molecular orbitals, since the other electron can also be considered in the same way. The orbital corresponding to the ground state energy is the ground state orbital for the molecule. And the two energy levels E plus and E minus are symmetrically positioned with respect to the energy of an isolated 1s orbital. In the figure, we can see the orbital corresponding to the lower energy level, which is the bonding orbital, and the other one is the antibonding orbital. The bonding orbital is 1s sigma and the antibonding orbital is 1s sigma star. Now, what is the electron distribution in this case? The electronic charge being concentrated between the protons screens the repulsion between them for the bonding orbital. In the case of the antibonding orbital, the electrons are less in the middle and therefore unable to screen the electrostatic repulsion. Since the ground state molecular orbital is provided by psi plus, we will try to obtain the ground state of the hydrogen molecule by placing two electrons with opposite spins in it. And mathematically, This leads to a slated determinant of the form given by this equation. Psi equals 1 by square root of 2, and determinant psi plus alpha 1, psi plus beta 1, psi plus alpha 2, psi plus beta 2, where alpha and beta are different spin states, and 1 and 2 correspond to two different electrons. Now the spatial part and the spin part remain separate, and since the Hamiltonian is spin independent, we shall consider only the spatial part. So the molecular orbital psi mo is written as 1 by 2 into 1 plus s into 1 sa1 plus 1 sb1 into 1 sa2 plus 1 sb2. So the molecular wave function is written as a product of molecular orbitals which consist of linear combinations of atomic orbitals. This technique is known as the LCAOMO, that is linear combination of atomic orbitals, molecular orbital method. Now let us have a look at the ground state electron configurations of very simple diatomic molecules and ions. The ground state electron configuration of the hydrogen molecular ion is, as we have seen before, 1s sigma 1. For hydrogen molecule, it is 1s sigma 2, that is, two electrons occupy the bonding orbital 1s sigma. For the helium molecular ion, we have the ground state electronic configuration as 1s sigma 2, 1s sigma star 1. There is one electron in the antibonding orbital. And for the helium molecule, we have the ground state electronic configuration 1s sigma 2, 1s sigma star 2. That means there are two electrons in the bonding orbital and two electrons in the antibonding orbital. Now we know that the antibonding 1s sigma star orbital is placed as high above the atomic 1s orbital as the bonding 1s sigma orbital is placed below. Therefore, note net energy is released in forming the helium molecule. And this agrees with the fact that helium molecule is not found in nature. In the same way, the ground states of some other diatomic molecules can be represented as like this. Lithium 2, it has electronic configuration 1s sigma 2, 1s sigma star 2, 2s sigma 2. Nitrogen molecule, it has electronic configuration 1s sigma 2, 1s sigma star 2, 2s sigma 2, 2s sigma star 2, 2p sigma 2, 2p pi 4. And oxygen molecule has the electronic configuration 1s sigma 2, 1s sigma star 2, 2s sigma 2, 2s sigma star 2, 2p sigma 2, 2p pi 4, 2p pi star 2. Let us take the case of the oxygen molecule. Since the antibonding orbital 2p pi star can accommodate a total of 4 electrons, the 2 electrons of oxygen that go into 2p pi star will go into different pi orbitals with spins parallel according to Hund's rule. The ground state of oxygen then will have 2 unpaired electrons. Thus, the oxygen molecule has a permanent magnetic moment, that is, it is paramagnetic. Now, similarly, the nitrogen molecule will show a diamagnetic behavior since there are no unpaired electrons in the ground state. Now, the population of the bonding and antibonding orbitals give us a concept which is called the bond order, which is a measure of the strength of a bond between two atoms. Now, the bond order for a molecule from a molecular orbital calculation is defined as bond order equals half into N bonding minus N antibonding, where N bonding and N antibonding are the number of electrons in bonding and antibonding orbitals respectively. For the hydrogen molecule, we can easily see the bond order is 2 minus 0 divided by 2 equals 1. That is, there is one bond between the hydrogen atoms. In the case of helium molecule, the bond order comes out as 2 minus 2 divided by 2 equals 0, implying the lack of bond formation in such a system. Now, apparently, the valence bond method discussed in module 9 and the molecular orbital method discussed here seem to be quite different approaches to understand chemical bonding. However, it is easy to see that they are quite related to each other for the simple case of the hydrogen molecule. Let us expand the molecular wave function of the hydrogen molecule, where we have disregarded a numerical coefficient in the front. Now the expression becomes psi molecular orbital equals 1sa1, 1sb2 plus 1sb1, 1sa2 plus 1sa1, 1sa2 plus 1sb1, 1sb2. Now what do these terms represent? The first term, that is 1sa1, 1sb2, tells us that electron 1 is at proton A and electron 2 is at proton B. The next term, 1sb1, 1sa2, tells us that electron 1 is at proton B and electron 2 is at proton A. The third term, 1sa1, 1sa2, tells us that both electrons 1 and 2 are at proton A, and the fourth term, 1sb1, 1sb2, tells us that both electrons 1 and 2 are at proton B. So the first two terms are same as the valence bond wave function for the hydrogen molecule. And the next two terms describe the cases when both the electrons are in either one of the atoms. But those are nothing but ionic terms. In one case, the atom A has all the electrons and so has a unit negative charge, and the atom B has a positive charge, and the other term depicts the opposite situation. It appears then that in this case, we can write the molecular orbital wave function as the sum of the valence bond wave function and ionic terms. And alternatively, we can look at the valence bond wave function as an approximation where the ionic terms were neglected.
Let us now summarize what we have learnt in this module. Firstly, the molecular orbital method provides an alternative approach to valence bond method to describe molecular properties using the techniques of quantum mechanics. The molecular wave functions or orbitals are considered to be superpositions or linear combinations of atomic orbitals. Conceptually, the electrons are thus not localized in bonds between atoms, but delocalized in the entire molecule. The construction of molecular orbitals by linear combinations of atomic orbitals leads to formation of bonding and antibonding orbitals, where the bonding orbitals correspond to stable molecular states and antibonding orbitals correspond to unstable states. The valence bond method can be shown to be closely related with molecular orbital method, in which contribution of additional, for example, ionic terms are considered.